personal shipwreck, and it indicates that there was already a very intensive trade within Southeast Asia.
Dong Song.
This is Dong Song period, the late Dong Song era. It's about this time that the first Chinese envoys actually went to Archaea. This is after the fall of the Eastern Han Dynasty. It's a Three Kingdoms period, the famous sword fighting period. Now, certainly after this, by the Tang Dynasty, beginning in the 7th century, we begin to get more ceramics from even further west. These are Arabo Persian type ceramics, like at the upper right. This is from the Kokokeo site. We get these Persian Gulf type of turquoise ceramics, also the Lam Po site, together with Tang Dynasty Changsha ware it's here, and Arabic glassware. It seems that by the late Tang Dynasty, 8th, 9th centuries, the Malay Peninsula had already become a major meeting point for traders from the Indian Ocean and the South China Sea. And ceramics was definitely one of the major kinds of materials which was being transported around by this time. This is the first period when the Chinese seem to have begun to produce ceramics intentionally for export. Already export ceramics had begun by this time to be an important occupation in China. So we have this famous shipwreck which is in Singapore, but was found in Western Indonesia. Let's see if it was there. The Batu Hitam shipwreck it's called, which is at the junction between the South China Sea and the Java Sea off the west coast of Borneo. And it was an Arab ship, interestingly enough. But carrying about, well, we recovered about 55,000 Changsha wares from the ship, and there are about 5,000 other types of Chinese wares as well from various kiln sites, and about, well, a very small number of Arabic wares too. It's been dated to about 835 by some inscriptions on some of the materials on board, carbon dates, coins, and so forth. There's a major controversy, you know, about the ship. The Singapore Tourism Board bought the cargo. So it's actually mostly sitting in the warehouse in Singapore, yet. A small quantity of it is on display at this point. In other words, well, I'll show you a few of them. We have a few examples from there in the NUS Museum, where we're going to take you tomorrow morning. So you'll see a few examples from the site. But so it's by far the largest quantity of early ceramics on any ship in the world. Huge quantity, indicates that already by this time the Chinese were mass producing ceramics, and they were actually exporting large quantities of this. This Changsha ware, as it's known, is only found in a couple sites in China. Yangzhou, which is a port near the mouth of the Yangtze River, and Changsha itself, where it was made, which is way down in Henan province, up the Yangtze and south of it. There's Changsha down in the Jizhou. Yangzhou is near Hangzhou, near the mouth of the Yangtze River there. These are the major Chinese kiln sites of the Han Dynasty, which is about the same time that the Khmer began to produce glazed ware. And you can see most of them are concentrated in southeastern China, in the Guangdong, the Fujian, and the Jiangxi, and Zhejiang provinces. And it's estimated that by the 13th, 14th centuries, the late Song Yuan period, maybe 10% of the population of Fujian was occupied in producing ceramics, a large proportion of which was meant for export to Southeast Asia. Fujian is not a very prosperous province. It has poor soil, rocky, mountainous. You're not originally from Fujian, are you? No. You're from Shandong.
From Hong Kong, it's a province.
Oh, it's Changsha also.
You see the river above?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's on the Yellow River. Yeah. Shandong province is close to the Yellow River, and it's the eastern of the province is the ocean. Quite close to the Korea and Japan.
Right. It's a big province, the peninsula sticks out there.
Yeah,
right.
Maybe
they
have some
trade. Maybe. Possibly. We have found on the Changsha wreck also Dingware, for example. So there's ware from Ding, from a couple of northern Chinese sites, but mostly Changsha. So it had to go from Changsha all the way down the Yangtze River and where there was a Yangzhou port. Yangzhou was actually the one that was at the end of the Grand Canal, which leads from, yeah, from all the way up to North China. It was already in existence by this time. So we will find, probably at the Chonek site also, some Chinese wares. Right, Tong Tong? Is there some Chinese ware?
Yeah.
And we will find some Chinese ware also.
Yeah, in Angkor.
In Angkor, definitely. Yeah. And probably, what about Chonek? Is there any Chinese ware at Chonek?
Some from Guangzhou, Jinsha, and Longgan.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, Dehua.
Dehua also.
Yeah.
The white ware. Okay, so we will
and also many Ding.
Oh, Ding as well.
Yeah.
So quite a bit. Well, not for both. We'll see about the proportion later. So these are examples, some from the Tang, from the Tang shipwreck off of the Lichong. So many of these Chinese inscriptions on them. We may find some Changsha. Changsha has been found in the Angkor area. Tang whitewares, however, were the most popular in Cambodia, you will see. Changsha ewers, also a very common form. Many of these were found on the Lichong. We find these around the Javanese archaeological sites. We found some on the Jian Plateau. We did an excavation there. We found some in also the Ratchaboko Plateau and so on. There's quite a bit of Changsha in Java. Whereas in Sumatra, a lot of what you find are these so-called yue wares, green wares. Some of these are from from Guangdong, Badarudin Museum site, the other sites of the Sri Wijaya Kingdom. There's quite a bit of this Yue greenware in southeast Sumatra. Now, the Intan, one of my students, Australian, did his PhD by collector on this Intan shipwreck, which was found off southeast Sumatra. It's a late 10th century, Five Dynasties period. A lot of Chinese wares on this one. Around the same period, this is the same kind of ware which is probably being made in South Thailand. This is the fine paste ware, so-called. Many of these examples were used for making these water vessels called pindis, or the spouts. And this seems to have been made mainly in the South Thailand area, Patani area. But a lot of it seems to have been exported to Indonesia at this time. It was probably one of the most popular Southeast Asian export wares before the glaze ware began to be exported in large quantities. So these are some of the amazing examples we found on the motor shipwreck. This was the Chittagong shipwreck. There are a lot of this is the Bakau wreck. The Bakau shipwreck. So a lot of the shipwrecks we find in Southeast Asia have representative examples of this South Thai ware, along with the Chinese ware. Not as many as the Chinese, but they were certainly in the same ships at the same time, the same cargoes. Northern Song, Cordichina, again we find lots of examples of this all over Southeast Asia, Cambodia, Indonesia. Greenwares, Song Dynasty saw the major growth in the ceramic export industry in China. Many different sources, the green, the whites, the Dehua, Dingware, Chufu. These are some of the examples we find at the Cordichina site, for example. And but in Southeast Asia, for the most part, the greenwares make up maybe 60 to 70% of the Chinese wares, whereas in Cambodia, it's the opposite. The Cambodians had a very different taste in Chinese ceramics. Almost all of the wares we find in Cambodia are white, which was rarer. It's higher quality for the most part, more expensive. But Cambodia, for example, specifically purchased white wares from China. And so there obviously was the Chinese had to have tailored their exports to the Southeast Asian markets, not the other way around. It was the Southeast Asian consumers who dictated what kinds of pottery was exported to them from China. Wang Dayuan talks a lot about this. Wang Dayuan wrote a book about the Southeast Asian commercial scene in the 14th century. And every port he mentions, he says, this is what the local market will absorb. this is the kind of Chinese porcelain which will sell here, and the next port over wants a different kind of porcelain, so on. So there was actually a lot of differentiation among the Southeast Asians in terms of their preference for the Chinese wares. These are some of the beautiful Qingpai wares from various sites. This is the kind of thing that we are more likely to find in Chongyang, for example. This beautiful, some of it's called Qingpai, which means shadowy blue. That's a kind of bluish white color, a very difficult color to produce. That's typical of the 12th, 13th, 14th centuries. Greenware is the most common. That's what we find mostly in Singapore. More white wares, Yuan dynasty types, these are from the Singapore sites. Stoneware is, however, the more common, these kinds of more utilitarian vessels from China. I'll talk more about them tomorrow when we go to the NUS Museum. These are some more interesting examples of typical Southeast Asian innovations in pottery. These are, you can see it's a piggy bank. That's a pig at the lower right. The Southeast Asians invented the piggy bank. And these are other examples from, these are both from East Java. And they were meant for containing Chinese coins. Chinese coins were already the major currency in Southeast Asia by the late Song period. The Chinese often had to issue proclamations forbidding the export of money to Southeast Asia. It was draining the Chinese economy. Now, China had an imbalance of trade with Southeast Asia in the Song Yuan period. But the Chinese kept on smuggling coins out anyway in return for Southeast Asian natural products for the most part. Things like ivory, incense, things from the forests. And so we find thousands and thousands of Chinese coins on some shipwrecks by the ton, literally. And this was used by as the official currency of the Majapahit Kingdom in Java. They made the actual hollow piggy banks to keep them in. This is the pre-Islamic period, when the pig was not yet forbidden. And we have all these other unique kinds of terracotta art, also from 14th century Java. A lot of terracotta figurines were made. That one in the top center is probably meant to represent a Chinese. Because Indonesians never show their teeth. They would always cover their mouth. Whereas foreigners always are depicted with their mouths open, showing their teeth, which is kind of an animalistic thing to do. And they're usually shown as laughing for some reason. As a Chinese, that seems to be a European at lower left with a big mustache and so on. There were miscellaneous Italians and other Europeans who made it to Southeast Asia in the 14th century. They seem to be the ones depicted here. Now, these are the only examples of glazing I've yet discovered in Indonesia. Probably in the 14th century, but it's lead glaze. Lead can be used as a glazing material in place of silica, but it melts at a low temperature of only 900 degrees, as opposed to silica, which is more like 1300 degrees. So they were making some lead glazing in Cholulan, but it's the only type in Indonesia I've found. Blue and white began to appear at this period. Southeast Asia was the first market for blue and white porcelain. So Southeast Asian ceramics only really began to be studied about the late 1960s. At that time, nobody knew basically anything about Southeast Asian pottery. Now, Singapore has formed the Southeast Asian Ceramic Society in 1969. And there was the first group actually to devote itself to the study of Southeast Asian pottery, but these were all connoisseurs and collectors, with the exception of the founder, who was William Willits. He was the founder of the NUS, at that time it was the University of Malaya, Art Museum. And they came out with this first book on Khmer ceramics, 9th to 14th centuries. That was the first publication on the subject. Before that, and still at that time, no actual kiln sites had been excavated. They only knew things from collections, from private sources of these kinds of miscellaneous wares, and there was almost nothing known about the provenance or the actual dating. In the last few years, since the mid-1990s, a number of excavations have been conducted on kiln sites since about 1995, mostly in the Angkor area. This is Angkor, and that's the purple area are the various sites in the Angkor region. And the map upper left shows where Angkor is in relation to Cambodia as a whole. So most of these sites which have been excavated so far have been done in the last 15 years, and mostly east of Angkor. And this is the area right around Angkor, between Angkor Wat itself and the Phnom Penh Plateau. These are some of the examples of some of the wares from the Tanam wreck site. Latane was the first one to be excavated. This is the Tane area. And this is the way the kiln looked when it was excavated. It's just in a mound. And you can see a bit of the fire pit at the lower right. That's about all that remains. They're not made out of bricks. They're made out of just hardened clay. And these are some of the various types of wares made here, both covered boxes and also architectural ornaments, roof tiles and rooftop adornments, pinnacles. Now, Phnom Kulen was known to have the probable kiln sites on it, but until the 1990s it was out of reach. They are still demining the area. You can see upper right, that's the demining halo group's sign saying don't go off the path here. But this is the village. I'm on Tom. This is where my student Wong Wai stayed when she was doing her PhD research. A nice little village. These were the types of artifacts lying around there, mainly covered boxes and architectural ornaments. There's a very good source of clay here. That's the lower left. That's actual source of clay. Japanese potters are still using this clay. And Japanese potters actually acquire some of this clay and take it back to Japan. Very good source of clay. Very, very simple white. And this is the excavation of that kiln site. That was partially sponsored by the Southeast Asia Ceramic Society. So that's what Wong Wai was allowed to join this excavation, otherwise mainly done by students from RUFA, the Royal University of Fine Arts, and lecturers from there. Now, the kiln was of a very interesting structure. It had these steps. You can see at the upper right, the profile of the kiln has those horizontal steps cut into the hillside. So far it's a rather unique attribute. Usually you don't have those steps like that. And these are the various types of ceramics found here, this particular site. And the report of this you can get from our working paper series here. That was by the Asia Research Institute in the US, so you can get this so you can read our report on that archaeological site on the home. Next site we worked on together jointly between Singapore and Cambodia, this was the Bakaung area. That's about 20 kilometers southeast of Angkor Wat. Now, there are some very early Angkor sites like this mine, the Bakaung site here. And this particular area was being bulldozed to build some government offices in 2007. And it was those are all the kiln sites which were then discovered during the bulldozing. All those red dots. 39 kilns were found in Bakaung. And so we did a quick survey. These are some of the government early office buildings already being set up there. The surface of the ground had almost been totally scraped off. But they dug a pit here, and you can just about see the outlines of a kiln right in the middle. On either side, you can see the sloping downward. That's a pile of the wasters from the kiln. So they did a very nice profile for us through the kiln with a bulldozer. And then we excavated, we found a few broken pots still in the kiln. Kilns were not used very many times. Kilns, you know, basically have to be destroyed every time you use it. You seal it up, you fire the pots, then you have to break into the kiln to get the pots out. And so a kiln may be only used maybe two or three times. But these kilns were mainly made out of just fired clay anyway, not brick, so they were easily repaired. Usually they would build beside the old kilns. Usually it's very difficult to work out the sequence of the kiln. They tend to be built on top of each other. But here you have some ceramics left in the kiln, the ones broken during the fire, and they didn't even bother to take them out, which are useful for us. That's what we often find. Now, these are some of them. And the Khmer have a very elaborate vocabulary in Khmer language. Unfortunately, none of us here speak Khmer. All of us in the archaeology unit speak Indonesian. None of us speak Khmer language, unfortunately. But Khmer has very elaborate terminology for specific types of pottery. Again, an indication of the importance of pottery in Khmer culture. These are pun, I can't pronounce that word, pun kuk, and so on. But you will learn more about this vocabulary when we're in Cambodia. We did a carbon-14 dating of this again. We got the dates carbon-14. So it comes from about the late 10th century, that particular site. Toktai was a site that was done just a year and a half ago. It's about 50 kilometers east of Angkor. A very interesting site. So this is it's along the ancient road which led from Angkor to the east.